Imagine you had to select 10 to 20 ideas you would like to remember the longest. What would they be? And is there some sort of mental locker, a mental vault we can put them in? So when our memory crashes, is there a black box? An interesting paradox about the memory is that when we want to keep something in mind, we do exactly the opposite. We put it out of the mind by externalizing it. For example, yesterday I received over 100 messages saying happy birthday, but these messages do not longer touch my heart as they used to, because the only thing it tells me is that all my friends are using iPhones and Facebook to remember me. But in us is the desire to be recognized and to be remembered. Mutual recognition defines the difference between talking to a loved one and talking to a stranger. Now, I'd like you to visualize the house you call home. Walk around in it. Probably there are several rooms and several objects related to persons you care about. Make a scale model out of it. Now, this is a detailed scale model of the house of my grandparents. Let me show you what Alzheimer does at the end stage. This is what my research is about. How can we slow down this impact? Scientists estimate that over 100 million people on this planet are suffering from Alzheimer's disease. And more than half of them isn't even aware of it. People in the early phase of Alzheimer's disease have a particular sensitivity with the problem of retrieving proper names, making it hard and difficult to recognize and remember their significant others. Now, I was wondering, if we are willing to carve the name of our loved ones in the bark of a tree, can we do that to the bark of our brain? Not a while ago, I was sitting in a large audience, and I was listening to a communication expert. He was also a CEO of a large advertising company. And he said something that really hit me in the face. Sometimes you have these moments that you absorb an idea. And he said, the goal of our communication is to anchor or attach the message in the long-term memory of our consumers. And if you think about it, it's obvious. You cannot buy a product you forgot the name from. But I was thinking, can we use these techniques to place something more valuable in the minds of others rather than a redundant need or a useless brand name? With this in mind, I went to some researchers at the University of Nottingham. And they are specialized in quality of life and communication strategies regarding Alzheimer's. And they said to me, it's about time. Individuals like you stand up and tell a positive story in a negative world. So they inspire me as a doctoral researcher and they motivate me as a human being. That's the reason why I stand here today. One of the patients they took me was an old man. He was about 80 years old. And his wife was sitting next to him, covered in tears. And I gave him a picture of his daughter. She was 30 when she died. And I asked the man, if you look at this picture, who is this woman and what does she mean to you? And with the most neutral face, he said to me, I had a walk this morning. Can we change that? Can we do something about this? Let me tell you about a woman I know. She's about 50 and she lost her son during a car crash. He crashed his car against a tree, and this tree is located on the road, and this woman had to drive every day from her home to her work. And every time she passed the tree, she was crying because it reminded her of her son. Now, can we use this mechanism for something positive? Can we use a positive emotion instead to make it more easy for an early Alzheimer to recognize his significant others? We believe so. Because what this woman is actually doing is building a memory palace, or is it, as it is referred to, the method of Loki. It's a very simple mnemonic strategy, and I'd like to take you through it in three simple steps. First, you have to select and memorize a series of distant Loki or locations along a familiar pathway. In our case, this will be the familiar pathway will be the house the early Alzheimer currently lives in. In the second phase, you have to create interactive images along that represent the stimuli you would like to remember. And in a third and final phase, you place these interactive images along the loci you selected in the first place. Now, before I destroyed this scale model, I worked together with an architect to work on a prototype of a memory palace in 3D and in virtual manner. I'd like to share with you today. So, the ambition of our project is to enhance memory for familiar faces and for people in the early phase of Alzheimer's disease. And by that, we hope to improve the quality of life, not only for the patient, but also from their significant others. Most early Alzheimer's still live on their own. Therefore, professional architects will use the construction plans of the houses they currently live in to make virtual scale models, resulting in an externalized and customized tailor-made memory palace. It's a recent trend to use virtual reality not only for computer games, but also in healthcare. I think that's a good trend. So, let's have a look inside. This is the house of my grandfather. And these are the people he would like to remember, his significant others. How can we do that? But first, the most important of our most important insight of our project is not only to increase the quality of life of the patient, but also of significant others. Taking care for Alzheimer's is very depressing, but investing in the mutual recognition might counterbalance this. So, first, professional trainers will use guided imagery to help my grandfather generate interactive images along the familiar pathway. Next, this information can be used by architects to place digital family photos next to objects related to the name of that particular person. For instance, my grandmother's name is Julien. Imagine my grandfather associates her name to the word Juliana soup, and therefore links her face and her name to the object of a soup bowl. In our mind, we have different circuits to retrieve common names and to retrieve proper names, and the second is mostly damaged by early Alzheimer. A possible reason for this might be that proper names like Frank or Tom or whatever are very arbitrary and meaningless. What we are doing is actually adding color, meaning, and emotion to it to make it more memorable. Further, imagine that my grandfather associates the name of my youngest cousin, Lambert, to the object of a lamp. Notice how the lamp is standing into the seat instead of next to it, because we know that the stranger the image is, the stickier it is for the mind. So we are breaking routine. Okay, what we have done for one room, you can do for the next. And what you can do for one floor, you can do for the next floor. So we expect this virtual scale model to be a convenient instrument, enhancing the mental walk of early Alzheimer's and allowing to practice it independently and resulting in an increase of life, not only for themselves, but also for their significant others. So, what we expect is a positive impact on the activities of daily living, on independency, on quality of life, and ultimately reduced cost for society. So, to come back to our scale model we have right here. What I'm saying is not that we can avoid the impact, but what we can do is slow down the impact. So, if there is anything positive about Alzheimer's disease, it is probably the fact that it offers us the the moral obligation to review our priorities. What's really important in life is other people and the ability to recognize and remember them. So I want to make sure that you don't have to walk like this before you realize that. Today, you can start by adding emotion and color to your life. You can start by breaking routine and old habits and making sure that every experience is unforgettable. Thank you for inspiring me. I hope I did the same for you.